Chapter 1. Stands. Singer can improve his voice. If this sounds like magic, the story of Tansingh is equally magical. Even today, many famous musicians follow the style of music created by Tansingh, known as the Gwalior Gharana. About 400 years ago, in a village near Gwalior, lived a wealthy poet, Mukund Mishra, and his wife. Their only sorrow was that they had no child. On the suggestion of a friend, Mishra went to Gwalior to seek the blessings of the famous saint and musician, Muhammad Ghaus. He tied a holy thread on Mishra's arm, saying, "May God bless you with a son." And so it came to pass. A child was born and named Tansingh. As Tansingh grew up, his father engaged teachers to teach him to read and write. Tansingh, however, was more interested in going to the nearby forest with his friends, where he would imitate bird and animal sounds. Once a group of singers were passing through the forest, Tansingh hid himself in some bushes and roared like was developing his musical talent. During that time, Mohammad Ghaus introduced Tan Singh to the ruler of Gwalior. They became good friends, and Tan Singh would often visit the ruler's palace, where he would listen to other musicians. During his visits to the palace, Tan Singh met Husani, one of the women who attended on the ruler. Like her name, the beautiful one, Husani was truly beautiful. Tan Singh fell in love with her and married her. A few years later, Mohammad Ghaus died, leaving his property and money to Tan Singh. Tan Singh settled in Mohammad Ghaus's house and his family was raised there. One day, a messenger arrived from the court of Rewa near Gwalior. The messenger opened the scroll and read, "King Ramchandra of Rewa would like you to be a musician at his court." This was a great honor and the first step in Tan Singh's rise to fame. King Ramchandra admired Tan Singh's singing and lavished many expensive gifts on him. Once he gave him 1,000 gold coins. Then one day, Emperor Akbar went on a visit to Rewa. King Ramchandra arranged for Tan Singh to entertain his royal guest. The emperor was greatly impressed by Tan Singh's music and, soon after his return, sent a message to Ramchandra, requesting him to send Tan Singh to his court. King Ramchandra did not want to part with Tan Singh, but he could not afford to displease the powerful Akbar. After all, Akbar was the emperor of India, and Ramchandra was only the king of a small state in Akbar's empire. So, reluctantly, King Ramchandra sent Tan Singh as a royal gift from one court to another, escorted by his own men. Tan Singh received a royal welcome in the capital city of Agra. Akbar was so impressed by Tan Singh's music that he bestowed on him the highest honor of the land. Tan Singh was included among his Navratnas, 9 jewels, the 9 most outstanding talents of the royal court. Besides performing in the court, Tan Singh would often sing alone for the emperor. At night, he sang rags that would soothe and help Akbar fall asleep. And in the morning, Tan Singh sang special rags that would gently awaken the emperor. There are many stories told about the power of Tan Singh's music. It is said that when Tan Singh sang, birds and animals would gather to hear him. Tan Singh sang and taught music in Emperor Akbar's court for many years. He was not only a musician but also a poet. He wrote the words for his music and composed many new ragas. When Tan Singh died, Emperor Akbar was at his bedside. The emperor was filled with great sorrow. He knew that India had lost her greatest musician and singer. But Tan Singh's music has lived on and been passed on from guru to disciple. And every year in Gwalior, near Tan Singh's tomb, a music festival is held. Musicians come here from all over India to perform and pay homage to Tan Singh. Anonymous. Chapter 3. Instead of the War Drum. Theme: War. Peace. Kickstart. Do you know the story of Buddha? He was born as a prince who gave up royalty and riches to spread the message of peace and kindness. Discuss in class the simple ways in which you can contribute to make the world a better place to live in. For example, you can start by being kind. Sent to Sri Lanka by their father, Emperor Ashoka, to help to spread Buddhism. Mahindra has been preaching Buddhism to the people of Sri Lanka before his sister arrived. Sanghamitra began to work with the women of the country and started an order of female monks or nuns. She also carried a cutting of the Bodhi tree under which Gautam Buddha attained enlightenment. Legend says the tree she planted still thrives in Sri Lanka. Emperor Ashoka was an ardent Buddhist. He took many steps to popularize the religion, both within his own empire, which covered most of the Indian subcontinent, including what is now Afghanistan and Balochistan, and abroad. In addition to sending his children to preach in Sri Lanka, he recruited Buddhist monks and sent them as emissaries to countries as far as Syria, Egypt, and Macedonia. Many prominent Buddhist monks and officials from Ashoka's court also went to Southeast Asia to propagate their religion. He built a number of stupas, which are believed to hold the relics of Buddha. The Sanchi Stupa, built by Ashoka, is now a World Heritage Site. In addition, he erected a number of inscribed pillars, one of them being the Ashoka Pillar. Similar inscriptions have also been found on boulders and in caves. In all, 33 such inscriptions have been found, which are collectively referred to as Ashoka's edicts. The inscriptions proclaim Ashoka's belief in the Buddhist principles of Dharma, or non-violence, and his intention to win over people by good deeds. They also talk about his social efforts to protect his subjects, both humans and animals. Emperor Ashoka is referred to as Devanam, the Adisi, beloved of the gods, in these edicts. But Emperor Ashoka was not always called the beloved of the gods. When he was a young prince, Ashoka's nickname was Chand, Fierce Ashoka. It was a well-earned nickname. As a young child, Ashoka had a skin disease that made him unpleasant to look at. His father, Bindusara, did not like him very much. So, Ashoka decided to prove himself. He became a fearless warrior. down and dreamt the world was upside down. When he woke, he looked about, raised the window and looked out. I seem to know this station too. Is it Nalchik or Baku? Tell me what it's called, he cried.
Petushki, a voice replied. Up he jumped. It's a crime. I have been riding all this time, and here I am where I began. That's no way to treat a man. What a muddlehead was he, that man who lived in Petushki.
Frederick Ogden Nash, 1902 to 1971, was an American poet born in Rye, New York. During his lifetime, Ogden Nash was the most widely known, appreciated, and imitated American creator of the light verse, a reputation that has continued after his death. Frederick Ogden Nash.